This film is dedicated to all of those loyal souls who over the years have attempted to unravel the Yagi story. These results have come from painstaking hours of work in an attempt to unravel the mystery. Miles of computer printout. All of this to unravel the greatest mystery in radio communications. Steady there, old son. The realization of these antennas having been designed takes many forms. These little blokes, this is a Leap Yagi, these others, these are television antennas, are all realizations of the Yagi design. Sometimes referred to as bird perches. And the constructors of these apparatus often stand off and gaze in wonderment at the results of their labours. And the birds too. Some of these gadgets can be taken indoors. And here we have a couple of bright young men showing us some Yagi antennas. Thanks, chaps. Now, it seems fairly unreasonable that these rather innocuous pieces of hardware should cause so much agitation and concern among the constructors and users the world over. But such is the case. So we've decided to go back to square one and examine the whole business right from the beginning. Here then is a traditional three-element Yagi antenna. Now, for a start, the Yagi antenna is different from any other kind of antenna system. And the reason it's different is because energy is taken to the driven element via this transmission line and extracted from the driven element via the transmission line. All the other elements, this director and also the reflector, are not fed directly with energy from the transmission line, nor do they feed energy directly to the transmission line. The other elements are called parasitic elements, the director and the reflector. And this is what makes the Yagi different from other kinds of antennas. It is called a parasitic array. And this is the array that we're going to study. The parasitic elements, that is the shorter ones, can form an array of directors. This is an array of short dipoles, which are not resonant at the operating frequency of the antenna. They are spaced out according to a particular recipe, and there are many. And this forms what we describe as the director array. If we wish to launch a wave on this director array, we excite it with a small Yagi structure. An energy is then launched from the small Yagi structure onto the director array. Now, this allows us to divide the antenna up into two quite independent sections. And having done so, we can analyse each of these independently or we can analyse them collectively. Now we're talking here about the long Yagi array, driven, as we see, by a shorter array being a normal conventional three-element array. The array structure, the total structure, combined, will have a particular free space length. We refer this to this as the array length, not unreasonably, and this may be several wavelengths overall. The Yagi structure is referred to as a slow wave structure. These red dots indicate half wavelength periods along the length of the structure. The wave is slowed down on this structure. It has a similar characteristic to coaxial cable, that is, the velocity of propagation is slower on the array than in free space. These black dots we're now putting on indicate imaginatively how the wavelength on the array may differ from that of free space. This then is one of the aspects of the long Yagi array which makes it rather unique. It is a slow wave structure. Energy travelling along the structure travels more slowly than in free space. So that's the first thing that comes to mind about the Yagi array. Great argument takes place, of course, about the gain of Yagis. Aaron Speck and Poller, in a paper published many years ago, drew this graph. And as you will see, the gain varies very little as a function of element spacing for an array of given length. We might say that 0.4 of a wavelength would be a good spacing to use. This is well spaced so that we don't have too much hardware aloft and is less than the cutoff frequency seen here, starting to occur approximately 1/2 wavelength spacing. This then is the gain versus element spacing for an array of given length. If we take this rather imaginative structure here of 6 wavelengths long, we have a rather large structure at low frequencies, and we place our director elements at 0.4 of a wavelength, we can build up a quite large array which will have the maximum achievable gain for an array of this kind. Let's again look at Aaron Speck and Poller's graph and see that the maximum spacing we ought to use is somewhere around about 0.4 of a wavelength. And we have set our director spacing in this long 6 wavelength array at this figure. 0.4 wavelength between successive directors. If we now plot the gain of this structure as a function of frequency, we note a cutoff here which corresponds with this 0.4 wavelength situation, and you'll see relates in a similar way to the gain versus wavelength spacing or spacing of the elements in the other graph. The bandwidth of the structure, and we're now talking about the transmission bandwidth, is defined on this graph as you see. We might decide the centre frequency will correspond perhaps to the resonant frequency of the drive section of the array. The cutoff frequency is a function of the director spacing, and we've set that at 0.4 of a wavelength, and the low frequency cutoff has something to do with the reflector. Let's look at this now as we sweep the response curve of a typical long Yagi array using a spectrum analyzer. A comb generator feeds it. Here is our design frequency, the one we want to use, and the comb is 5 megacycles per input. We've now contracted the display and we see this cutoff frequency quite sharply defined and the lower frequency region rolling off very much as though it were a bandpass filter. The marker indicates our design frequency.
We caught the bugger. Good night all.
plotted line, there is a diode detector, and this diode detector feeds the VSWR meter, which is in fact simply a DC voltmeter. And the other output from the slotted line is the load that you wish to measure. This setup enables you to measure directly the VSWR of the load and also the actual impedance of the load.
This is a view of the complete slotted line test arrangement. This is the test oscillator, which is tunable between 220 MHz and 920 MHz. This is a suitable range as the test antenna is Ed Tilton's 432 MHz Yagi. The test oscillator is modulated by a 1 kHz square wave, which is necessary as the operation of the slotted line is dependent on the modulation. This is a T-junction where we take off a bit of the oscillator output for accurate frequency measurement. This is a slide attenuator on the oscillator output. This is the 500 meg low pass filter to ensure that the frequencies existing on the slotted line are of the test frequency only and not harmonics. This is a 10 dB attenuator. This is inserted between the oscillator and the slotted line to stop any loading of the oscillator. This is the slotted line itself, and the actual transmission line is behind the scale. The transmission line has an impedance of 50 ohms. This is the diode detector and a tuning stub. The tuning stub on the slotted line is provided so that we can provide an output of less than 2 millivolts for the VSWR meter. The VSWR meter operates on a square law detector rule, and for that to be the case, the output from the diode detector here
can duplicate in the laboratory the bandwidth characteristics that we've described for the antenna. We'll use a spectrum analyzer here in the storage mode as a receiver, which can record the amplitude versus frequency characteristics of an antenna. The particular one we've chosen to plot is a television antenna operating in the high end of the Australian television allocation. If we plot the transfer characteristic, or the energy transfer between this antenna and some receiving source, we'll begin to see the characteristic frequency response of the antenna. So let's plot this now using the storage facility of the spectrum analyzer to maintain the information for us. And as we go down in frequency, we observe that the actual plot of frequency versus amplitude is very close to our theoretical curve. In fact, we may conjecture which came first. And so here we see, in an actual case, and this is a laboratory example, not a free space example, we see that the general characteristics of the response are pretty close to our predictions. Here, this notch, you see, very clearly defined on the high frequency end. A little glitch here, we're not too certain about that, but fairly flat across the frequency range of interest, falling away on the high frequency or low frequency end there. Not too much ripple in the passband. We're looking here at 10 decibels per centimetre on the oscilloscope, and a few megacycles per centimetre in the horizontal scale there. And we have this little glitch there in the centre and falling off on the low frequency side. But the general characteristics of the response are pretty much what we have shown in our idealised diagram. So this then is the frequency response of the antenna, or an example of this particular type of design. Now, many people are concerned Well, you may ask just what is going on here. Well, I'd like to welcome you to a traditional amateur antenna raising party. Now, this is a strange and peculiar occupation indulged by radio amateurs, in which they all gather together at the shack of one of their mates and assemble the strangest looking lot of hardware you've ever seen in your life. They gather about, and you'd be surprised at the amount of engineering that goes into this sort of exercise. Apart from having to be, of course, a trainee steeplejack. Anyway, let's just watch this lot and see just what it's all about, then we can get down to the meat of the whole exercise. This seems to be some sort of an introductory slide, so we'd better get down to the nitty-gritty of all this. I'm Les Jenkins, and I'd like to introduce you to the Long Yagi. Now, here are a couple of Long Yagis stacked to improve the amount of gain available. These Yagis come in a variety of shapes and sizes, and over the years have led to considerable discussion, altercation, and indecision as to what is in fact the best way of going about the whole exercise. Whichever way you go about it, it invariably finishes up in a piece of hardware that might look something like this. Now this is a fairly large antenna system, and it all starts out, of course, in the building. The construction of the antenna has to be done with quite a degree of care. Now I thought I'd show you some of these practical aspects of the antenna, because a little later on, after we've looked at the film, I want to show you some work which has gone on since this film was made. So I thought I'd edit out a lot of the classroom type material and put in some of this practical material and do the classroom bit with you after we've looked at it. Now Collar's measuring the symmetry of the elements in this antenna at the present time, and having satisfied himself of that, the next thing is the matching of the antenna, or the feeder, to the driven element of the antenna. In this particular case we've used a delta match, which is a convenient and fairly well known method of finding the appropriate impedance in a driven element. In this particular sequence, I'm more interested in showing you here the sort of methods of attachment that we've used in the past. There are many varieties of attachment methods and so forth, but a couple of points here. We have used copper tubing as the driven element, and also for the feed wires, for the pure and simple reason that you can make a good electrical joint, soldered joint to copper, which is somewhat more difficult with aluminium. And so here, with some, not without some difficulty, yours truly is attaching the wire to the driven element at the appropriate point. A little out of sequence here, the setting up of the, or determination of the point, was done prior to the soldering, of course, and we'll have a look at that in just a moment. So Cole now sets about the business of making a good low impedance solder joint. Good on you, Cole. In spite of some of the problems, Cole seems to have succeeded in soldering it on. And now we have a look at the completed antenna. The antenna is some 25 feet long, and as you can see, held at one end by Rob LaVersia, VK3ZLJ, and the other by Cole. It just fits across the 30 feet of width in the factory. Now, in setting up the feed point, we use the spectrum analyzer in conjunction with this directional coupler and the signal generator, and by measuring the return loss of SWR, we can find the appropriate point of attachment. Now I'm going to use the spectrum analyzer again this evening and show you how this is actually done, but I've put this shot in which is not related to that particular antenna, but is just one that I happen to have that's reasonably good contrast. This is actually the measurement of VSWR, or return loss is the way we measure it, of a television antenna. This one covers from 170 to 230 odd megs there. And the trace that you're seeing there now is the actual reflected power from the termination. And you can see that it's got that classical dip there just to the left of the 200 megacycle point. And this is another one that I dug out from somewhere or other, which is sufficiently different to make it interesting. The next segment of our film is with Peter Cozens, who's head of department at Box Hill Tech. Pete's going to go through the measurement of gain of an antenna system with us. So here's Peter Cozens.
We'll set up for a gain bandwidth measurement. You need an energy source. In this case, we did use an oscillator. It is possible to use an amateur transmitter of suitable frequency. We have a reference dipole here. We have the antenna to be tested here. We have a changeover system. Free space, preferably a fair distance, with no interfering bodies. Another reference dipole. In the first instance, the reference dipole is connected directly to a receiver. Alternatively, it may be connected to the receiver via the attenuator. Step number one is to take a reference with the attenuator switched out from the oscillator through the reference dipole, through the second reference dipole into the receiver. Then switch your energy source to the antenna to be tested through free space. Switch in the antenna attenuator and adjust the attenuator so that the receiver reads the original signal strength that it was reading without the attenuator switched in.
And say from the classroom to a practical situation. To measure the gain of an antenna requires a considerable effort. Antenna design engineers prefer not to discuss in detail their methods of measurement and the problems associated with this particular measurement, which is quite difficult to make and quite tedious. Firstly, of course, one has to mount the test antenna in a suitable fashion. With the assistance of Col VK3YII, we are about to undertake the measurement of a 70 centimetre long Yagi antenna by way of demonstration. The antenna is firstly affixed to a suitable support structure. Col here wastes no time in making sure that the antenna is firmly attached to a suitable supporting mast. We must have, of course, a reference against which to measure the performance of the antenna. We have chosen to use a dipole mounted in front of a plane reflector rather than a dipole to which we may make reference. This antenna is relatively free from reflections and will suitably standardise our test setup. Up aloft, Col deploys the antenna. Down below, we have a Hewlett-Packard 312A connected to a receiver, which will give us a very accurate measurement of the relative performance of the two antennas. Looking down a test range of some 15 miles out across these trees, which under a practical situation is probably about as good as one can do. The antenna is directed down the test range and rotated until maximum signal is received by the remote indicating signal strength meter. Down below, the measurement is made on the Hewlett-Packard equipment as an anxious Col wonders just how good the antenna will be.
Well, after that little exercise, let's adjourn back to the chaps as the antenna erection party becomes merrier and merrier. Much technical discussion is the order of the day. Erecting these antennas is totally impossible, of course, without this discussion. Well, a little high wire work here, and gradually the antenna starts to take shape. In spite of warnings, that it's a bit big for the yard, but nevertheless, as you can see, it's starting to work, and some of our more courageous people take their turn aloft as the work party proceeds. So this is the construction, or the final part of the construction, is putting all this hardware together and attaching the feed lines, making sure that they are secured to the structure of the antenna or the array or the support structure, so that the cables don't chafe, flap about in the wind and so on. And here much electrical tape is used and little bits of strutting here and there to brace up the structure. And the trees in the background show us that the wind, which is the bane of all amateurs, is already starting to make its presence felt. So the group goes about the exercise, paralleling up the cables and attaching the various Q-sections and transformers to make the system work. Here we get a close-up shot of the attachment of one of the feed points, which is in itself a Q-section, and elastic and electrical tape to ensure that moisture is kept at bay. And so eventually the antenna takes shape, somewhat obscured by the trees here in this shot, and at last the time has come to fire it all up and see if it works as well as we anticipated. And so these are the long Yagis, the big giants of radio communications, many decibels of gain, and this little single Yagi is now redundant, replaced by this rather enormous structure. And so I guess it's time now to call CQDX and see what the answer is going to be.
5ZCHVK6WD, well, if Ron wasn't transmitting, it must be imagination. Although it sounded very much like it, it just seemed to drop out. And I don't see why I could have imagined it, but anyway, worth a check on it. And if he was not modulating it, say, 3 or 4 minutes ago, and was not on 1296, well, I can discount that as having heard anything. You're right then, Les, we'll look over your frequency from time to time.
In connector is just panel mounted onto the screen reflector. See there? And it comes through onto the feed system of the half skeleton slot on the front. As you can see, this is a similar arrangement except for the fact that we have little trimming vanes here which are used to get the VSWR down to a more acceptable level. In fact, somewhere in the order of 25 dB return loss. And as you can see, the feed system is accomplished in the same way, and the plane reflector at the back as usual, and looks quite good, and we'll hope it all works.
Well, we hope it works too, Gary. The apparatus which Gary is holding there and showing to us is the feed system for this 12 foot parabolic reflector. Installing the apparatus in the focus of the dish is quite an exercise. And let's now follow Gary as he goes about the precarious business of putting the feed into the antenna system. Thank you.
1, 2, 3, 4. Well, here's the station site, and of course, like any radio station, it needs a mast and antennas so that it can radiate its signals and receive signals coming into the station. Antennas don't grow on masts, they have to be installed. And the following scenes that you will see are the occasion upon which the antennas for VK3R TV were installed by a crew of highly experienced people, all experts in their job, and able to do these tasks with a minimum of fuss and effort. So let's join the crew now as the antennas for VK3R TV are erected on the tower at Mount Olinda. Getting the antennas up the tower, of course, is quite an exercise. And here we're using a long rope tethered and bringing the antennas up to Rob, perched precariously on the tower, helped here by O'Brien and Rodney, holding the other end of the catenary cable that we've run so the antennas may slide easily up to the head of the tower and then be affixed. And Rob secured to the tower with a safety harness. I think he's got a safety harness. Well, anyway, secured to the tower with a safety harness, watched by the ground crew with some trepidation.
has got a safety belt on, hasn't he? I thought he had. Well, Rob secures the antennas, and waiting down in the shack below is the equipment to which the antennas will be connected. This is VK3 RTV, amateur television repeater at Mount Olinda. Well, the task is completed, and Rob climbs down the tower after spending about 3 hours aloft, and is greeted by Peter, VK3BFG, with a hearty handshake. Well done, Rob. So now it's back into the shack, and the boys gather around and discuss the result and various aspects of the performance of the system. And so they all gather now to discuss the matter, and well, let's just join the group now discussing the result.
Looking at the base of my tower.
Well, who have we got here? I'm Les, 3ZBJ.
Peter, 3BFG.
Rod, ZLW.
Brian, 3HB.
Rob, 3ZLJ.
Well, that's about it, I think.
Yep.
Good work.
Great stuff. Let's get it.
I don't think Skip's shortened up enough yet for Red. Haven't heard Red come up yet, so just wondering if they all have set the hatches on. Where Red is there, I couldn't say, but he hasn't turned up yet this morning.
And that's the end of our film. So if someone would be good enough to attend to the lighting, and we can then go ahead with the chalk and talk, and we'll investigate a little further the mysteries of the Hiage antenna. Thanks for your attention, and we'll have the lights on, and we can continue on then with the story.